Good afternoon. Welcome to Shankara Academy of Visions, Learning from the Master's Series. At the outset, let me tender my apologies to you for our delayed start, which was due to internet connectivity. I'm very sorry for that, but we'll make up with a great talk from Divakar, who is my faculty from Shankara College of Optometry, Bangalore. Divakar is a graduate and postgraduate from Lotus College of Optometry and has been associated with Shankara College of Optometry from the beginning. He has a special interest in binocular vision. He teaches binocular vision and also practices vision therapy in Shankara Eye Hospital. Today, Divakar will be talking on non-strabismic binocular vision disorders and their examination. Over to you, Divakar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the brief introduction. And apologies to all of you for the delay at the start. And with no much delay, let us start with the session. And we are talking about non-strabismic binocular vision anomalies examination. So today's session, I'm going to talk about the tests which we're going to perform to evaluate these anomalies. Coming with the next two series followed with this, we're going to talk about Burgeon's anomaly by my colleague Nikita. And once again, followed with accommodative anomalies, I will be speaking once again on that with few cases. So to start with, we talk about a questionnaire which can be used for evaluating non-strabismic binocular vision disorders by with the help of a questionnaire. When your patient is waiting in the waiting lounge, you can pass on this questionnaire and it will help us to know about the vision therapy and as well as the stress what the patient is undergoing and what the difficulties the patient is facing. So this questionnaire was developed by a team of COVD fellows, that is College of Optometry and Vision Development, in 1995. Initially, they started off with 30 questions and later on they modified it to 19 questions. And advantage of this survey is, as I said, it is easy to administer, low cost and standardized it is. Disadvantage is when you want to elaborate, you have to sit with the patient and elaborate about the questions. And it can be a scoring and the scores can be taken for each question. It has options such as always, frequently, occasionally, and as well as seldom and never. So anything greater than 20 score out of added all these together, the patient is considered to be asymptomatic. And these patients can be taken for further evaluation in binocular vision. So before I go into the binocular vision test, very important is refractive error assessment. And very important with refractive error is subjective acceptance. So in subjective acceptance, we're going to do monocular tests. I'm not going to the detail of monocular tests because we are talking more in detail about binocular vision. We are more interested with binocular balancing. There are various tests for binocular balancing. One simple test can be done in clinical procedure is by doing a prism dissociation method, where we can use three prism base up in one eye and three prism base down in the other eye. You can do it either way by placing a base up and base down in the other eyes. And the patient will see a target like this. So one is shifted up and down. We will ask the patient which target is more clearer. Example, if you place base up in the right eye, the image will shift down. And if you place a base down in the left eye, so the image will shift up. So we'll ask the patient, the image in the up or the bottom is clearer. Based on whichever the patient says is this clearer, we'll place a plus lens in front of that eye and we will relax the accommodation. So binocular balancing is done to equally balance the accommodation between the eyes. And I have a video on that, how do we do this clinical procedure. So first you find out the monocular subjective endpoints. And once you finish with the monocular subjective endpoints, place that in the trial frame. Do a NRA by giving a near target to the patient. So keep a near target at 40 centimeter distance. And you start adding plus lenses binocularly. And when you start doing this plus lenses binocularly, at a point where the patient says there is a sustained blur, record that value and keep on adding plus lenses binocularly. So we keep on adding plus lenses over here. So at certain point, the patient says it is sustained blur. You record that value where there is a sustained blur. Then you show a distance target of 636 target or 660 target. Place one eye base down prism and the other eye base up prism. So you can see that in the right eye, we have placed base up. In the left eye, we have placed base down. This is how the patient will see. The image will shift up. And in the other eye, the image will shift down. So we can see that. And we will ask the patient, which is clearer? You can see the right eye was clear. Left eye is blurred. So right eye image is clear. So we'll place a plus 0.25 diopter lens in front of the right eye. So we'll place a plus 0.25 diopter lens in front of the right eye. So the patient says to the right eye, it is clearer. So we place a plus 0.25 diopter lens in front of the right eye. And then we take out the prisms. So we'll remove the prisms and we'll start defogging binocularly. And still the patient is able to see clearly. We keep on continue to defog. At one point, the patient says is able to read 6x6. So we'll stop there and you can see through this lens, both the targets are clear with this lens. So this is equally balanced between the right eye and the left eye. So that's binocular balancing test. And this is the values where the final prescription is on. So the next we perform a sensory test where we perform word for dot test. And word for dot test, we show four dots with two green, one red and one white target. So patient will wear red-green glasses in front of the eyes. And red-green target, you can see here. So when you use the green lenses, you'll be able to see only three dots. And when you see the red lenses, you're able to see only two. So if the patient is able to see all the four, like in the picture A over here, so that indicates the patient has good fusion. If the patient is able to see only two red, that indicates the left eye is suppressed. Or the patient says, I'm able to see only three green, so that indicates the patient is suppressing the right eye. And if the patient is able to see five dots, based on that, we can come to know if the patient has esotype of deviation or exotype of deviation. So this is the case where the patient has diplopia. So how do we record? We record for distance, intermediate, and near. We can do it for all the three distances. And we record fusion, suppression, and diplopia. And based on which distance you're doing, and we can record it if the patient has fusion, suppression, which eye is suppressing, and is there a diplopia present or not. So the next test is stereopsis. So we basically use to evaluate the presence of depth perception. And we can also know if the right eye is suppressed or the left eye is suppressed. So we have local stereopsis or a contour stereopsis. Here we use a Titmus fly or animal target or a word circles. And we will ask the patient to find out where is the wings of the fly is and which animal looks popping out. Followed with that, we'll also ask which circles, out of these four circles, which circle is popping up. Disadvantage of this procedure is it uses monocular cues. So because of that, you may overestimate the stereopsis. So the next stereopsis is global stereopsis, where we use a random dot stereoscope, stereopsis chart. This helps us to determine the better constant strabismus and presence of strabismus. So the normative value for stereopsis are 40 seconds of arc. And we can see we are performing a stereopsis in this patient. And we ask the patient to wear Polaroid glasses, hold the target stereopsis chart at 40 centimeter distance. You can measure that with the scale. This has to be done over the best corrected glasses. And you can see the patient is holding the wing. The patient is not touching the book. So that indicates he is able to elicit stereopsis. And out of these A row, you find out which animal is popping out. In B row, which popping out. And the C. And you can ask which circle is popping up. Ask the patient to tell or touch on the target. And the interpretation is given on the backside. And we can come to know what is the maximum stereopsis of the patient. So when do you stop this test? If the patient is able to complete all, or when the patient does two consecutive wrong readings, the previous right reading will be taken as stereopsis of that patient. So the next test is cover test. And this is divided into three major parts. One is cover test. The second is cover uncover test and the alternate cover test. So cover test is used to check the amount of, basically if the patient has any tropias, then we use cover test. And when do we perform cover uncover test is when to identify or to detect stereophoria, we use cover uncover test. Followed with that, we perform alternate cover test to find out the amount of deviation of phoria or tropia. So, very important over here is when we perform cover test is we should have an accommodative target, and this will give us a proper estimation. Example, if you're not using an accommodative target and the patient is under accommodative, so you may overestimate the degree of exophoria and underestimate the degree of esophoria. So also very important when you do cover test is move the target and see if the patient is able to follow and fixate at the target, and you're able to find out if the patient has a good fixation when you're performing the cover test. And for that, you move the target slightly and check for that. So the normative value for cover test is if the patient has for distance one exophoria with a standard deviation of plus or minus 2, and three exophoria with a plus or minus 3 will be considered as normative values. So here I have an example and animation where we are doing a cover test, and you see there is no movement in the left eye when we cover the right eye. So that indicates the patient is ortho, there is no deviation at all. In a second case, you can see esophoria over here. So when you cover the right eye, under the cover, you can see it is deviated. And as soon as you remove the cover, it moves outwards to take up deviation. So that's esophoria. So the next one is exophoria. When you cover the right eye, under the cover, you can see the eye moving outwards. And as soon as you remove the cover, it comes back and take a fixation. So that's exophoria. Then you may see patients with intermittent type of deviation. Initially, they will show as ortho. But once you break the fusion, the ortho will go into tropia. And now you can see initially you started as ortho, but once you break the fusion, it has gone into tropia. So we have a subject over here on whom we are performing the cover test. For that, we show an accommodative target. And when the patient is looking at the accommodative target, and you can see the patient is looking at the accommodative target, and you can use an occluder. We prefer to use a translucent occluder to find out the deviation behind the occluder. So now you can see that the patient is looking at the occluder and we have covered the left eye. You can see there is an exophoria under the cover, the eye has deviated. Now it moves into take up fixation. Yeah. And you can see we do it in the right eye as well. And you can see the right eye moves into take up fixation. So that's very clearly indicates the patient has exophoria. And we can do it with a distance target and as well as for near target. So how do we record this in a case sheet? We mentioned the esophoria or exophoria, or the short terms can be used to record esophoria or exophoria on the case sheet. And once we find out that, we perform the prism bar cover test to find out the amount of deviation. So in this patient, the patient is having exotropia, you can see the left eye has deviated, and we cover the right eye, the fixating eye. And when we cover the right eye, you can see the left eye moves in to take a fixation. And when you cover left eye, right eye moves in to take a fixation. So now you introduce a prism. Example, we introduce 20 prisms over here, and then we perform cover test. And you can see there is no deviation is present. So it gets neutralized with 20 prisms. If you use less than this 10 prisms, you would have seen small amount of exo deviation still. Now, instead of 20 prisms, if you use 22 or 25 prisms, you would have started seeing an opposite movement, that is esophoria. So how do you record this? With the amount of deviation and the direction of deviation will be recorded on the case sheet. Next is a fourier assessment. Can be done with various methods, Maddox rod method, modified Thorington method, and von Graffé method. The easiest and commonly practiced in clinical practice is modified Thorington method, where we have a Thorington chart and we require a Maddox rod. And the equipments required are a transilluminator or a pen light. Then we require a Maddox rod and a Thorington card. So this test will help us to know the vertical and horizontal amount of foreas. So in this subject, we have measured horizontal fourea. So where we have placed a Maddox rod in the right eye and examiner is holding the Thorington chart, the distance Thorington chart at 3 meter distance, and the light is projected to the center of the chart, and the patient will be able to see a light source as well as the line. So when we ask the patient is able to see the line. So patient is able to see on the left side of the chart with respect to the light source. So that indicates the patient has exophoria because we have put the Maddox rod in the right eye. There is a cross fixation. So you can see there's an exophoria, and we can ask the patient to which number the line is matching. And we can also find out from this test what is the amount of exophoria. So recording, we do it as if the line and the light is exactly in the center, so then it is ortho. If you find it is slightly deviated based on which direction, so we can measure exophoria and esophoria, and we can record this, the amount of deviation. As we discussed the normatives, one exophoria for distance is normal, and three exophoria for near is normal. Next, coming to the accommodation tests. Accommodation tests are divided into amplitude, accommodation facility, and response of accommodation, and there are other indirect tests for accommodation. So we will talk one by one. First, we will talk about amplitude of accommodation, which can be measured by three different ways. One is push-up method, pull-away method, and minus lens method. So let us talk about the first expected values of amplitude of accommodation. So we have various standard values are available from Donders and Durrance. Recently, we have started using Hofstetter's formula. So the formula for minimum and average is given over here. If you know the age of the patient and if you substitute that in this formula, you will come to know the amplitude of accommodation, which is minimum or an average required for that patient. Then we can measure the amplitude of accommodation of that patient by doing push-up or pull-away method. And we can compare it with the average or minimum. So does the amplitude of the patient is less than normal or it is better than the normal? So a push-up method, what we do is we keep a target away from the eyes and we get it closer to the eye and where the patient will say there is a sustained blur. So, or the patient says blur, then we'll ask the patient to blink. And if the patient says it is clear, we'll take the target much more closer towards the eye. Still, the patient says it is clear even after blinking if we cannot make it clearer. So we record that distance from the lateral canthus to the scale, and that value will be taken as near point of accommodation. So we can use the targets which are smaller, one line better than the best corrected visual acuity in the better seeing eye. And we can use the fixation targets for these patients. In this case, on the right hand side picture, you can see we have kept the target close to the eyes, so it is blurred. So you take it backwards where still the patient says, I'm able to see clear. So that indicates the pull away method. So advantage of pull away method is we can do this in a pediatric age group who doesn't understand what is blur. So we can keep the target close to the eyes and then take backwards where the patient is able to see clearly. So make a note, whatever the target you have used, the patient should have not seen it before, so that it makes it easier for you to understand if the patient is able to see clear, then you can say what is written on that. So now we're going to demonstrate a push-up test. So in this push-up test, you can see the target is moved closer towards the eye. Still, the patient says it is blur. Once it is blur, we'll ask the patient to blink and get it further closer, so and we can record the value. So in this example, it was around 13 centimeters was the near point of accommodation of this patient. In a pull-away method, we have kept the target close to the eyes and we are taking the target backwards. Still the patient says there is a clear target. When the patient says it is clear, you stop and record the distance from the lateral canthus and measure that distance as near point of accommodation. So in this case, you can see it is a 14 centimeters is the near point of accommodation. So you can convert the near point of accommodation into an amplitude where 100 divided by example, you got 20 centimeters for a patient. So 100 divided by 20 centimeters will be 5 diopters will be the amplitude of accommodation. And we can measure the amplitude of each patient based on what is their near point of accommodation. The next method is we can use a minus lens to blur method where we start adding minus lenses monocularly. And still the patient says there is a sustained blur. And wherever the patient says you sustain blur, you stop. Add that value because you kept the target at 40 centimeter, you're stimulating 2.5 diopters of accommodation. Add that value to the 2.5, you'll get the amplitude of accommodation. And in minus lens method, it is estimated that it gives around 2 diopters less than the push-up method. The reason behind it is minus lenses causes minification. So in the video, when you start adding the minus lenses, the patient will see wherever there is a sustained blur and you will record that value and add it to 2.5 diopters. The next one is accommodative facility. So this test is done to check the speed at which you can relax and stimulate accommodation. You have to make sure that the patient is wearing the best corrected glasses for near. Over that, you have to select the flipper. And for selecting the flipper level, you should know the amplitude of accommodation and keep 30% of that value. And half of that value can be taken as reserve and you can decide the amplitude of accommodation, what diopter power should be used for that particular patient. And you should keep a near print target, which is one line better than the best corrected visual acuity. In front of the monocularly, and you can do that. So this picture we have shown it binocularly. And let me show you a video of monocular accommodative facility and binocular accommodative facility. How do we perform monocularly? So make sure that the patient is holding the target at 40 centimeter. You measure that with the scale. Then ask the patient to occlude, or you can use a trial frame and occlude the eye. And you can use an accommodative flipper in front of one eye. Also use a timer so that we can measure in 1 minute how many times the patient is able to relax and stimulate accommodation. So in this video, you can see that the patient is looking at the target. You measured 40 centimeter. So we ask the patient to read and the stopwatch is started and you start flipping, so you can see the target, what the patient is seeing, and you can start flipping the accommodative flipper. Start with the plus lens first so that the patient is able to relax the accommodation. And then you start with the minus to stimulate the accommodation. So both you start doing simultaneously. And if the patient is finding difficulty with either of the lens, record that with which lens the patient is finding difficult. And also record at end of 1 minute how many cycles the patient is able to come. So you can see that with the plus lens and the minus lens when you flip. So what happens? So you can see the target has become magnified and minified with the help of the plus lens and the minus lens. And now we are performing binocular accommodative facility. And you can see here when you're performing binocular accommodative facility. So we are flipping and you have to do it faster. And the patient is able to see the target and record how many cycles you're able to complete in 1 minute of time. Next, some of these patients will have difficulty with plus lens or a minus lens. If there is a difficulty with plus lenses, that indicates there is an accommodative excess, or patients who have convergence insufficiency, those patients will have difficulty with plus lens. Or if a patient has difficulty with minus, that indicates there is an accommodative insufficiency. Hello, is it here? Okay, sorry for the inconvenience. We'll continue from here. So we are talking about accommodative facility, and I was talking about interpretation of accommodative facility. So if you have monocular tests showing abnormal, so it's a very clear indicator of accommodation problem. If the binocular tests are abnormal in accommodative facility, so binocularly if you're not able to perform, it's an indicator that there is a problem with vergence, or it can be a combination of accommodation and vergence anomaly. And these are the normative values for monocular accommodative facility and binocular accommodative facility. So the next is accommodative response. This is a test to check monocular estimation method. MEM can be performed over here. So this will help us to know the lead and lag of accommodation. So what we require is an MEM card which is attached to the retinoscope. So you can see the various MEM cards which are being attached over here. So you require a trial set, a trial frame, MEM card, and the retinoscope. So how do we perform? Examiner measures the distance of 40 centimeters from the eye, and you ask the patient to look at the target, and you perform retinoscopy on one eye where the patient is looking through both the eyes. And if you see a width movement, you neutralize with plus lens and see how fast we are performing the plus lenses are being placed and removed. And still you get a neutral, and whatever value you get, the neutral will be recorded. Remember, when you're performing this MEM retinoscopy, you should not keep the lenses for longer period of time, so that can plus lenses can relax the accommodation and minus lenses can stimulate the accommodation. So this video is from the examiner's point of view. When you're performing, measure the distance and when you're doing. So you ask the patient to look at the target and read out the target when you're performing this test. And based on if you see a width movement, you neutralize with the plus lens, or if you see against movement and neutralize with the minus. So based on this, we can come to know what type of accommodative response the patient is able to give. So the normative value is around 0.25 to 0.5 with a standard deviation of plus or minus 0.25. If you have more than 0.75, that indicates that the patient has lag of accommodation. And if the values are towards plano and the minus value, that shows a lead of accommodation. After we talked about accommodative amplitude test, accommodative facility test, and the response test, the next test which we're going to talk in accommodation is the indirect test for accommodation. So that is NRA and PRA. So how do we perform NRA and PRA? This is performed binocularly, where we give a target at 40 centimeter and you start adding plus lenses initially, and still the patient says there is a sustained blur. Then followed with that, you decrease the plus, come back to zero, and start adding minus lenses where still the patient says stimulate the accommodation, still the patient says there is a sustained blur, record that value. So we can see that in the next coming video. In this video, you can see, so we have placed a plus lenses and we keep on adding the plus lenses, and still the patient says there is a sustained blur, you keep on adding the plus lenses. Continue adding it till the patient says there is a sustained blur. And once the patient says there is blur, and even after blinking, the patient is not able to see clearly. So you have to keep the target at 40 centimeter distance. So keep on adding plastic. Why not? So once the patient says it is blurred, it cannot see clear further. So then you decrease the plus bar, come back to zero, and then you start adding minus bar binocularly. And keep on adding minus bars till the patient says there is a sustained blur. So remember, when you place a minus lens, take out one lens and then place the other lens. So don't keep minus lenses together. So take out a minus and then place a next minus. And we can see that in this patient. So we were able to perform that, and we recorded the value of this patient. We got minus 2.5 as PRA value and plus 3 as NRA value binocularly in both years. So the next test is correlating the accommodation and vergence together. So the test where we are checking AC by ratio. In AC by ratio, we are going to check with one diopter of accommodation how much that prism diopters of accommodative convergence is stimulated. So we can do this by adding plus lenses or minus lenses. Minus lenses will stimulate the accommodation. A plus lenses will relax the accommodation. When you put a plus lens, accommodation is relaxed and that causes divergence. And when you put minus lenses, so stimulation of accommodation happens. So that causes convergence. So if you have exophoria after putting a minus lens, your exophoria will decrease. So you can do that in the various method by doing calculated method or a gradient method. Most commonly, we do gradient method in the clinical procedure. And in calculated method, we get proximal vergence playing a role. So that's why in gradient method, we estimate slightly lower value than compared to the calculated. So coming to the test for vergence, so we are going to talk about near point of convergence. So in this test, near point of convergence, we are going to do with help of RAF ruler, or we can use a near target. This is to check the amplitude of convergence. We can do it with an objective way or a subjective test. Objective way is we see the eye being deviated when you bring a target close to the eyes. Subjective is when the patient will say, I am seeing double diplopia. So you record that. So the repetition is very important in this, because initially when you perform one or two times, your fusional ranges are helping it. So that's why you have to repeat it a couple of times. And the target which is used is, you can use an accommodative target or you can use a non-accommodative target like a light source. So example you can see here. So in this case, we have used an accommodative target. And we are using this vertical target and getting close to the patient. And wherever the patient says, I'm seeing double, you record that distance on the scale. And that will be the subjective assessment. Objectively, if you see any deviation, that can be recorded. So in this second video, we are performing the test with help of an RAF ruler. And you can see the target is brought close to the patient. So we will ask the patient where there is double, you record that distance on the RAF ruler scale itself. So you can get the target close to the eyes, and wherever the patient says it is double, you record that distance. And as we discussed earlier, it has to be repeated a couple of times so that you get a proper values. You can see, you can record the distance on the RAF ruler, how far, what is the value. The next test is step vergence. So this test is performed to check the positive fusion vergence and negative fusion vergence, the amplitudes. And how do we perform this is binocularly. So you have to find out the blur target. And usually if you find a blur, that indicates the accommodation is not responding. And whenever you find break, that means your vergence has the maximum amplitude has reached. And recovery is once you decrease the prism diopters, once the patient is able to see single and clear, that is where your accommodation and vergence both are able to regain its function back. So we are performing a positive fusion vergence and negative fusion vergence in this patient. And you can see that in this video. So we give a distance target to the patient. Patient is looking at the distance target. One isolated letter, or you can use a vertical target. So we started using a basin prism. We started slowly increasing the basin prism. Still the patient says, I'm able to see blur or double. And so we keep on increasing the prism here. And you can see the patient says, I'm seeing double at this point. So you record the value from the scale. So it is showing around 12 prisms. And now you decrease the prisms to get the recovery value. And wherever the patient says, I'm able to see single and clear, you record that amount. So in this case, it was around 8 prisms. The patient says it is single and clear. So now we are performing base out prisms, and we're slowly increasing the base out prisms. Still the patient says it is double. And in the same way, we can decrease the prisms. Still the patient says the recovery value is. So now the patient is able to see double with base out for distance. And we got 14 prisms over here. And we are decreasing the prisms. Patient says it is single and clear now. And we record that value as 10 prisms. And same way we can perform this test for near, with a near target. So patient is looking at the near target and then you perform the test. So the normative values for base in and base out, that is positive fusion vergence, we use base out prisms, and negative fusion vergence, we use base in prisms. So this test has to be performed with best corrected glasses. So we have to do it for distance and then for near. And we always do with base in, that is negative fusion vergence first, and then positive fusion vergence. These are the normative values for positive fusion vergence and negative fusion vergence. The next test is vergence facility. Here we are performing a vergence facility test with help of a vergence flipper or a biprism. And this is to check the dynamics of fusion vergence, that is the speed at which you can converge and diverge. So you measure the vergence stamina with this, and what part to be used, you can use it. So, with the help of this, we're flipping the flipper, and the patient says it is single and clear, then you go to the other side of it, and we record the value, cycles per minute. For 1 minute, how many cycles the patient is able to complete. And the normatives of this is given over here. age group between 5 to 7 or 2.5 cycles per minute, an age group of 8 to 10 or 5 cycles per minute, age group between 11 to 13, 6.5 cycles per minute, and an young adult who is at an age group of an young adult, so around 8 cycles per minute will be considered to be a normal day. So thank you all of you for paying attention, and we regret for the intermissions in between, and like to thank Aditya sir for helping us to moderate this session, and also all my colleagues to help me out in this situation where we had an issue with the net. Thank you all. And also, I'd like to thank my students who helped me to capture these videos for this session. Thank you all. So if you have any questions.
Thank you, Diwakar. That was a very interesting session, though we had a lot of disruptions in between because of network connectivity. I apologize to all the audience for that, for the disruptions. Anyway, we'll try to make up with the question and answer sessions. Diwakar, we have a couple of questions right now. One is from Meghna. It is a multiple question, so I'll just split it into a couple of them. So she asks, in binocular balancing, what happens if we keep more prisms?
Okay. Meghna, to answer your question, in binocular balancing, we have to use as least prism as possible to dissociate vertically. If you look at the vertical fusional ranges, we have a value somewhere around 2 to 3 prisms. So in this example, I have used 3 prisms base up and 3 prisms base down. That means it's almost 6 prisms together. So this should be sufficient enough to dissociate the eyes. If you use less prism than these, so then the patient may not be able to see double, or it may be overlapping. So the test may not be able to perform well. And what is the highest prism you can use? You can use as number of prism as possible. But as you go to the higher prism, the contrast of the target will also decrease. So we have to use a least prisms, which is sufficient enough to dissociate two targets. So that should be sufficient for this test.
Diwakar, she also wants to know the tolerance level.
Yeah, the tolerance level is based on how much is the prism is required for dissociation. Example, if you use 2 larger prisms, more than 6 prisms or 8 prisms or 10 prisms, so the patients will have large vertical dissociation and they will not be able to appreciate 2 target very clearly. So as least as possible, which is supposed to use for dissociation, that should be good enough.
And the third question she has is, if the patient tells both the images are clear, then what should be done?
If the patient says both the images are clear, that means the binocular balancing is already done with the monocular subjective endpoints. So you need not add any lenses in front of the eyes. So that is good enough. But usually we have to do a complete fogging method where we did an NRA in this case. And with that correction, we have to give a distance target of 660 or a 636. Usually the patient will not say both are clearer with that amount of fogging lens. Usually this can happen with a minimal fogging lens. There is another method where they use a minimal fogging method where they just add 0.75 or 1 diopter and they show a 612 target and then they perform this test. In that case, yes, the possibility the patient may say it is both clearer. But if you do a complete fogging method, what we have done here, so the chances of patient saying both are clearer is less, but the patient may say both are equally blurred. So that is the most possible suggestion what can be given.
The next question is from Ms. Tripti Shah. She wants you to explain global stereopsis.
Tripti Shah, thank you for asking the question. So the question about global stereopsis, we have local stereopsis and global stereopsis. Local stereopsis uses the monocular cues, so they are dissociated targets one next to each other. Even without using a polaroid glass, because the targets have been dissociated one next to each other, so we can
I think there's a break again. We'll be back.
Sorry for that. Yeah. I was answering Trupti Shah's question with respect to global stereopsis and local stereopsis. Trupti Shah, when we go for a local stereopsis, the targets have been dissociated one next to each other, both the targets. Even without the help of your polaroid glasses, you can able to see those targets being dissociated with monocular cues. So that's one of the disadvantages of that. Whereas global stereopsis, we use a random dot background, and it is very difficult to find out with the monocular cues with that, and it's a better test than compared to the local stereopsis.
Thanks, Devakar. The next question is from Ms. Mohini Kumari Singh. She wants to know the stereopsis measurements in different age groups, the methods that you use for different age groups.
Which methods can be specific?
Basically, she
which
wants
test
to know
we are talking about?
Yeah, the stereopsis measurements. What are the different tests that are used for different age groups?
Yeah. For a different age group example, we have a pediatric age group who can give a subjective response. Then we can use a Titmus flight test and a random dot stereogram. Subjects who cannot give a subjective response are a very toddlers or a very small child. We can use this visual cliff. The test is called visual cliff, where we can make the child to sit on a box and it will have a slab on it. And at the bottom, there is a pattern. So if the child is able to perceive the depth, the child will not crawl across it and go to the other side. If the child is not able to perceive the depth, so the child will pass to the next side. If the child is able to perceive the good depth, the child will sit and not pass to the other side. So this is called as a visual cliff test, which is used in a very small age group children's who we cannot get a subjective response. Whereas if you don't have this, the simple test can be performed is you can have a bangle or any circular target and ask the child to put a pen or a pencil inside that. So if that can be an objective way of assessing it, but better tests are like visual cliff can be used. I hope that answers question.
Devakar, the next question is from Ms. Kajal. She wants to know, in which case do we perform modern optical fogging method?
Okay. In which test?
In which case do we perform modern optical fogging method?
Okay.
You want me to repeat
Kajal,
that?
Sorry, I have not, I'm not able to get that question because I have not.
In what case? In what case will you perform? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
In what cases do you perform modern optical fogging method?
modern optical fogging method, I'm not aware of this test, but the common fogging method, what we do over here is we find out the amplitude of the patient and we place that amount of dioptric bar in the trial frame and we do a defogging monocularly and we find out the subjective endpoint at the last by doing a duochrome test. Sorry, Kajal, I'm not aware of this modern technique of fogging what you're asking.
I think Devakashi is talking about the fogging that you used to totally fog the patient and then defog him.
Okay. So there are various methods. One method is, as I said, by finding out the amplitude of accommodation. The other method, what we can use is we can do an NRA and find out the NRA value and place that in the trial frame with a distance target. And then we can do a defogging. So this is another method which can be followed.
I suppose this question is coming from the fact that number of books and number of practitioners state that you fog up to plus one diopters or plus two diopters. So possibly that's a question. In case that answers your question, that's fine. Otherwise, let us know what exactly you want to know, Kajal.
Yes.
The next question is from Mrs. Devakani, and she has complimented you for a great presentation. She wants to know the difference between Thorington and modified Thorington techniques.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Devakani, for asking this question. And you know, Thorington method, earlier it was done at 6 meter distance. Then they modified it to do it at 3 meter and 40 centimeter. And now the latest modified Thorington is they have a target which are kept obliquely so that it can also measure horizontal deviation as well as vertical deviation. Both can be measured with this chart at 40 centimeter distance. So that's the difference between a Thorington and a modified Thorington test.
And she also wants to know if we can use this for vertical Fourier measurement.
Yes, it can be used for vertical Fourier measurement.
Mr. Himanshu Sapra wants to know why negative fusional versions is performed first and why not positive fusional versions?
Very good question, Mr. Himanshu. We have also done a study by doing couple of tests where we do a stimulation test first and the relaxing test later. And we have done it in a small sample size as a pilot. And we found out that not much of a difference between doing stimulation first and then the relaxation. But ideally, it is said that relaxation has to be done first and then the stimulation. So if you're able to do it on a large sample size, what our study we are doing, and we'll be able to justify that answer, probably we can come back to you with a good amount of data behind it.
Okay, Mrs. Devakani wants to know the normative PRA values.
Normative PRA values, as I had projected on the slide. So we have for distance and near. So for negative fusional versions is, normative PRA values.
PRA.
Sorry. So PRA values is, we stop the test at minus 3 because it doesn't have any significance beyond that. But if you continue the test, if you get a minus 7 or minus 8, because minus lenses will stimulate the accommodation, it doesn't have any significance. So usually we stop the test at minus 3. If the values are less than minus 3, that indicates the patient has difficulty in stimulating accommodation. So usually this happens when the patient has accommodative insufficiency type of cases. So in those cases, we find this PRA values are low.
Yeah, just to add to that, PRA is actually dependent upon the amplitude of accommodation. So it's variable for the, so there's nothing called normative PRA value. It depends upon the age and the amplitude of accommodation that your patient has. The next question is from Mr. Navneet Sharma. He has complimented you on the excellent presentation. He wants to know, Which method of ACA ratio is more accurate, calculated or gradient?
Mr. Navneet Sharma, thank you for asking the question. You asked about the gradient method and the calculated method. What we clinically practice is the gradient method. When we do a clinical procedure, we use the gradient method. The calculated method is also used, but we find that there is a difference between the calculated method and the gradient method. So that's because proximal margins playing a role. So that's why the gradient method will slightly underestimate than compared to the calculated method. But clinically practicing, we always practice gradient method over the calculated.
Ms. Kajal has come back with the explanation or the exact question that she wanted to know about the fogging technique. So she says fogging followed by NRA and then defogging to get best distance correction is a new fogging method, but which patient shall we include?
Okay, any patients when you perform retinoscopy and you find there is a reflex, there is a distance change in the reflex, obviously. So if the accommodation is playing a role, any patients with hyperopia and any patients with the latent hyperopia. So all these cases, we recommend to do a complete fogging method by doing an NRA and then giving a distance target and defogging.
I suppose so anyone who has
an all.
Please continue, Diwakar.
Sorry. So this test is almost equivalent to the cyclopegic refraction. So because we are doing maximum relaxation of accommodation by doing NRA. So most of the subjects have shown that the values cyclopegic and with this NRA fogging method is almost equal.
The next question is from Mrs. Shantini. She wants to know how to perform binocular balancing in patient having non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly like NRA is less. So I suppose she wants to know if the NRA is poor, then how do you do binocular balancing?
Okay. So you first find out what is the NRA of that patient. Basically, you're finding out the balancing of accommodation with this test. So even the patients with low NRA value, you will be able to get his accommodation balanced. Post that, we can find out why the NRAs are low and find out the anomalies which are related to it. But still, it can be performed. With example, if you did an NRA and you got a plus one as an NRA value, and still you can go ahead with that plus one and give a distance target and do a binocular balancing. Then later on, we can perform the other test once the binocular balancing is done to find out why NRAs are.
Mr. Jeevan Jha wants to know regarding WFDT, Worth 4-dot test. He wants to know that red and green colors are arranged in circular shape normally. Why is only circular shape used rather than any other geometrical shape?
A good question. We have to ask this question to people who have designed it. But I do have seen a different type of Worth 4 dots. Not only circular, I also have seen a rhombus shaped Worth 4 dot. I think the shape doesn't matter over here, whichever the shape you use. The matter is basically to find out the fusion or suppression. So the shape, geometrical shape doesn't play an important role as per me. Probably I can ask sir if sir has any inputs on this.
Yeah, the shape does not matter at all. And in fact, it need not even be dots. It can be anything. So you could have animal figures, you could have, so for the pediatric Worth 4 dot test, actually we cannot call it Worth 4 dot because there are no dots in that. So they have animal figures. So basically what it requires is red and green target and can be any arranged in any shape. Divakar, the next question is from Mrs. Preeta Ramprasad. She wants to know about RF ruler with proper positioning over cheek. If the target appears double at 5 centimeters, this distance is not really 5 centimeters when we measure with a simple ruler. Why is it so?
Ms. Preeta Ramprasad, thank you for asking the question. And with respect to the RAF ruler, so we have to take the values behind the RAF ruler, not in the front, because there is a distance which is kept, the target is slightly in front by two centimeters. So there is a possibility that you get 5 centimeters when you check from the plane of the target to the lateral canthus. You may get 5 centimeters, but on the scale, it will show you the different value. So whenever you do RAF, the values are taken from the scale, which is behind the ruler. And when you do the normal method, where you just take a target and get it close to the eyes, for that you take the lateral canthus measurement. So RAF ruler, you have to take the measurement from behind, do this and see, they both are almost the same.
Thanks, Divakar. The next question is from Sai Balakrishna. He mentions that he had a patient with vertical diplopia and he corrected him with 5 prism base up and 5 prism base down. I suppose in right and the left eye. After correcting the patient, responses were 80% diplopia was corrected. So can we prescribe, and how many prisms can we prescribe monocularly as well as binocularly?
Mr. Sai Balakrishna, you asked a question with respect to diplopia, and we have a separate session which is coming up for diplopia management as with the prisms. So we'll be able to talk more precisely over there. So just to give it, prescribe 5 prisms base up in one eye and 5 prisms base down in the other eye. So added together of 10 prisms. And you said 80% of the diplopia was corrected. And you're asking how much of the prisms to be. Sorry for the interruption.
Divakar, so, can you please repeat the answer?
Yes.
There was a lot of audio break.
Yeah, so I'll repeat the answer. Sai Balakrishna, your question was with respect to the prisms to be used. And as we were discussing earlier, we have a session which is coming up on prisms separately. And in this case, you said there is 5 prisms base up and 5 prisms base down. Added together, there are 10 prisms. And this 10 prisms, how much to be prescribed out of 10 prisms? We can measure that by using a Percival's or Shears criteria. If this was a case of a fovea, but if it was a case of paralytic squint, so then Shears and Percival criteria doesn't hold good over there. Then you have to prescribe the maximum amount of prism where we can decrease the diplopia and make the patient to see a single binocular.
So I suppose this is a case of diplopia. So obviously we have to prescribe the entire amount. It does not look like a case of fovea.
Yes.
Anyway, we will be discussing this in greater detail when we talk of diplopia correction. I think it is on the last day.
Yes.
The next is from Anoop Subedi. Mr. Anoop Subedi wants to know if saccades and pursuit test is required to do NSBVD examination and if it is compulsory or not.
Yes, when you're talking about oculomotor anomalies, it's also a part of non-submissive binocular occlusion anomalies. So in that point of view, we have to perform both pursuits and saccade tests. Yes, it is required to be done.
Mrs. Mohini Kumari Singh wants to know the significance of Worth 4 dot at different distances.
Very good question, Mohini. the significance of doing birth for dot at different distance to elicit or to find out if the patient has any small amount of scotoma. So that is the reason we perform this test at different distances. So as like visual acuity, you take the target which is far away and it will subtend a smaller angle and you're able to find out the smallest scotoma. And if you do it at closer distance, it forms a larger visual angle and which cannot find out the smaller scotomas. So that is the reason it has to be done at near, intermediate and distance. So all the three distances you have to perform this test. So there is possibility that patient may have good fusion for near and intermediate, but suppression for distance. So that is possible because when you're doing from distance, it is subtending a smaller angle on the retina and you're able to find out the smallest scotoma.
Ms. Mamoni Momita wants to know if one diopter stimulation of accommodation changes 4 exophoria to 1 esophoria, what is the ACA ratio?
Initially, it was 4 exo and after you put a minus 1 diopter lens. And minus lenses will stimulate the accommodation and that causes convergence to happen. And now it has gone into 1 eso. So the ACA by ratio is 5:1 in this example.
Yep. Mrs. Irene Sophia says, compliments you on your beautiful presentation. She wants to know, when in clinical setting will you decide to do pursuits and saccades in a patient and how is it done?
Very good question, Ms. Irene. With respect to pursuits and saccades, when we perform this as a clinical test, so if you find any oculomotor anomaly type of disorders, example, if the patient says, when I read, I skip lines, I miss lines, or when I read, I miss targets. And when I read, the letters are jumping and moving. So these are very clear indicators that it is related to ocular motility disorders. And these patients who have symptoms of related to these, so we will perform ocular motility tests. Along with that, we'll also do a pursuits and second test in the.
Thanks, Tawaka. The next question is from Mr. Vijay Verma. He has again complimented you on an excellent presentation. He wants to know, out of 4 methods for measuring amplitude of accommodation, which method is more reliable and accurate? Or does it vary on the basis of age?
Mr. Vijay, in this current presentation, I had explained about 3 methods. One is push-up, pull-away, and a minus lens method. There is another method which is called a modified push-up method where we place a minus 2 diopter lens and then we perform the test. If you consider that as the another method out of these 4 methods, in push-up method, the modified push-up is considered to be a slightly better method than compared to the normal push-up. Pull-away method is ideally used in clinical scenario in a pediatric age group who cannot understand what is blur. So the better to perform a pull-away method. And minus lens method, clinically, it is very less practiced. The reason is minus lenses causes vitrification and it also underestimates the amplitude of accommodation by 2 diopters. So the best method will be push-up or a modified push-up method for an adult.
Thank you, Diwakar. I think these are the questions that we have today. Oh, there's one more from Mr. Himanshu Sapra. What is the standard way to document birth for dot?
Yeah, in birth for dot test, the standard way to document is you have to do the test for all distance near and intermediate. And for distance, if you find fusion, you record as fusion. Instead of writing 4 dot seen, 2 dot seen, 3 dot seen, the other examiner will not know have you placed a red filter in the right eye or the left, a red filter in the left eye. So it is always better to perform which eye is suppressing, and it is always better to record it fusion or right eye or left eye suppressed, or if the patient is seeing diplopia, and also for distance, intermediate and near. So this is the ideal way of recording instead of writing the number of dots.
Yeah, and also if it is diplopia, whether it is eso or exo.
Yes.
Uh, There's one more question from Umana Giri. Complimented again on your presentation. Which cases we perform mainly four prism based out test?
Ms. Uma, very good question. I have not included this test in my presentation today. If you don't have a workflow dot test which can be performed for near with the workflow dot touch, or you're doing this, you want to do this test in the outside scenario where you just have a trial set, the simplest method you can use is four prisms. You can just place a four prisms in front of the eye, give a near target if you're doing for near, or a distance target when you perform for distance. And when you do this test, you will see the movement of the eye towards the apex, and you will see the eye fixating back because the other eye will also show you movement. So it's a very simple test to find out suppression. If you don't have a test like Worthford dot test, so then we, or Begononi striated glasses, a simpler test can be performed as a four prism based on test where you're checking the movement of the eye to find out the suppression is present or absent. If there is a movement, so the suppression is absent. If there is no movement, so that indicates suppression is present.
Dr. Mr. Anoop Subedi wants to know if there's any method to perform vergence and accommodation facility objectively, especially in the case of non-verbal patients.
Vergence and accommodative facility with a non-verbal patients, I have not come across with any of these tests, but what we ask the patient is, we ask them to show a sign language. If the patient is a non-verbal adult patient and who can understand it, if he sees clear, we ask him to raise the thumb, and if he's not able to see clear, thumb will be down. So we do that, and we have seen a couple of patients by doing this sign way of indicating that the target is clear, and then we flip to the other side and the patient will raise the finger that it is clear. Probably I can ask sir if sir has come across with any of an objective test for vergence and accommodation.
No, not really objective test. It's a subjective test, but non-verbal patients, it's not a problem because once a patient is able to understand what he has to report, if it is a blur or a double, and he can understand that, then he can show that he's able to see it clear or single. But if he is not able to understand, then it's not possible to do this.
Yes.
I think these are the questions that we have for you, Divakar. Thank you very much. Wonderful presentation. Again, I apologize for the disruptions that we had in late start and in between, and also the audio breaks. We'll try to work out and see to it that it doesn't happen again, though it was out of our control because the internet was not working well. Apologies again. So we see you tomorrow at 12 noon, same channel. Tomorrow, Nikita will be talking about how to diagnose and manage vergence anomalies. So she takes over from here after diagnosing vergence anomalies, how to handle them. See you tomorrow, same time, same channel. Keep safe, keep well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.